You know, this is a federal law, but it has terrific impact, I can tell you, on provincial and on municipal jurisdictions. The province ultimately ends up paying for the court costs associated with cannabis arrest and prosecution, as well as for the incarceration costs. And right here in your municipality in Victoria, we pay, of course, for the policing costs directly. And as you might have read recently in the paper, it's an ever-escalating police cost. In Victoria, despite the impression that we're tolerant of cannabis policies, we have the second highest rate of cannabis possession arrests in all of Canada, and for a city our size. BC, for the last 10 to 15 years, has led Canada out of all provinces in arrest rates for cannabis possession as well. And so, despite the perception that we're not arresting people in BC and here in Victoria, we're doing so at a higher rate than almost anywhere else in Canada. That's why I'm so pleased to have Mayor John Rands here with us today on this panel. Mayor John Rands is on his sixth term as Mayor of Metchosin. He's been elected official and public servant for over 25 years. I can tell you personally that as someone who served on the CRD board with Mayor Rands, that I have a great respect for the man. He's a real straight shooter. He does his work with a lot of integrity. And when I asked him to come on this panel, he said, "You know, Philippe, I don't know a lot about cannabis laws. I just know a lot about bad laws." And I said, "Well, that's perfect, because there's a demographic out there that's exactly in that same position as well." So when Metchosin Councillor Moralia Milne put forward a motion to have UBCM consider cannabis legalization, the mayor not only supported the motion, but Metchosin sought and gained support from the Association of Vancouver Island and Coastal Communities, and the resolution in question will likely be heard and voted on by UBCM delegates on Wednesday. So I hope you'll help me welcome Mayor John Rands.
Well, thank you, Philip, for the kind introduction. Philip was a remarkable member of the CRD board, and he really is missed there. It's unfortunate that you're not still there. I really don't know why I'm here, other than the fact that Philip asked me to. I'm not an expert on marijuana.
We have plenty of experts.
Yeah, we've got lots of experts, but I'm not personally even a fan of marijuana. I've got no desire to take it. I'm a farmer. I don't grow it. I'm going to grow the stuff that doesn't earn money. and I'm certainly not an expert on it. But I do have considerable experience. I do have, you know, law making is always experiments, but I do have considerable experience in making laws, both regionally and locally. And I really know how destructive bad laws can be. I'm going to, because I can't talk with any authority on marijuana, I'm going to have to slip into something a little more esoteric here and just tell you how laws are formed and the criteria that we should use when we're making. And I hope that we use when we try to reform this ones on the drug issue that we have right now. In a free society, in any free society, we must rely on voluntary compliance. In a police state, you don't have to so much. You can rely on fear, you can rely on intimidation, you can overrun human rights. But we can't do any of those things, and it's a good thing, too, in a free society. In a democratic society... in a democratic society, we have to rely on personal responsibility, and that's really what this whole thing is about. And because of that, there is a tremendous onus on those who write laws. Because if we write laws that don't work, and if we do it enough times, then ultimately our society doesn't work. So, in trying to think of what I was going to say today, and thinking about, okay, if we want to replace this thing, how do we best go about it? I sort of made a little checklist. how to make a law. And it's a checklist that people should go through, but often don't, unfortunately. It's very easy to sit there and respond to public pressure, or to be political pressure, or to have your staff suggest things and you just go ahead and do it. But you really need to go through this checklist if you're in the business of making laws. So the first question you ask yourself, what's the reason for this law? Is there a legitimate need for it? Or are you just responding to maybe political pressure, minority groups, whatever else? And you have to really research it. But you also have to ask, does this support the overarching objectives of our society? A lot of times we write laws just, you know, we need a law for this, we need a law for that, and we forget what it actually does to our society. And that's one of my big concerns about this one, the drug business. So once you've done that, and you figure that, okay, we do have a need, then you have to ask the question, does it make sense to our population? If it doesn't make sense, then we have no business making that law. Those of us who are making those laws represent the population. And if we're making laws that the population doesn't want, we shouldn't be doing it. So then the next question that we have to ask is a slight variation of that. Does it make sense to the target population? A lot of times we think, boy, that law, we need a law for this, but we forget that it has to make sense to the people that we're actually directing the law to. We've got a number of examples of failures when we do that. And when we do that, and write a law that doesn't make sense to the target population, you're guaranteed a lot of non-compliance, and that's when your troubles really start. Now, we know that whatever law we write is not going to make sense to some people, but we hope that it makes sense to few enough that we can then deal with it. So that's, once we get past this first set of criteria, let me take a look at the next place. First thing you have to ask yourself is can we enforce it? Can we enforce the law we just wrote or are about to? A good example are traffic lights. I mean, that's a municipal function. I mean, everybody hates getting stopped at a traffic light. Oh, geez, another red light. But we all do it. We do it because we know that it makes sense. If we don't do it, then we're putting ourselves and others in peril. Traffic lights makes traffic flow faster than it would if we didn't. So even though we don't want to do it, we still do it because it makes sense. And the very few that don't, it's easy to enforce it. It's easy to spot them. We have electronic means. It's easy for the police to see. And the penalties for it are quick and direct. So we can really enforce that law. If you get away from that a little bit, we've got speed limits, for example. Now, there's a lot of places in our province where the speed limits are a lot lower than the design speed. So there you're starting to see a lot of mass non-compliance, and people start driving, everybody. I mean, my municipality is a classic example. We have 50-mile-an-hour speed limits on 50-kilometer speed limits on 70-kilometer roads. So everybody drives 65-70. There's a non-compliance there, so the law has to accept, okay, well, we're going to have to give this big gap. We're going to have to ignore the law in a sense, because everybody's going over the speed limit. So you're starting to get away from it. You're starting to get non-compliance when you get into that thing. So that's something you really have to be careful. Can we enforce this law? The next question about enforcing is, can we afford to force the law? And that's a big one, especially for municipalities who don't have a lot of money. If your law is constructed in a way that in order to enforce it, you're going to have to go to a court, to the courts a lot of the times, then you're in trouble. First of all, you don't know what the outcome is going to be. Second of all, you're going to have to put in an awful lot of effort. You have to go through your bylaw enforcement, you have to do all, there's a great list of things in order to prepare for court. When you go there, all of this is very expensive. So if you realize, if you write a law that relies on ultimately taking people to court, then you're going to have to start either saying, well, we're just not going to be able to do it, or you're going to have to be selective about it. And as soon as you start doing that, you weaken the perspective, the public perspective of your authority. And that's very bad for your governments. As soon as the public starts to think, okay, well, you know, hey, these guys, they're not going to take me to court. They just don't have the money, we can see it, so I'm just going to go ahead and do what I want anyways. And that's when you start to get a breakdown of your governance and a breakdown of your laws. One of the things that, when you're creating a law, is that you have to look at what are your desired outcomes. And usually, when we're writing laws, all too often when we're writing laws, is that we look at it from a generalist sense. Yeah, you know, we're going to write this law and it's just going to be good for us, right? It's going to solve our problems. You don't get into exactly what it is that you want your desired outcome to be. If you did, then you'll start probably looking at more regulation than prohibition. The next thing, and this is something that is really not done often enough when we look at outcomes, is what are the undesired outcomes? Because every law that we write has got undesired outcomes. And you have to really look at it to make sure that your undesired outcomes don't overwhelm or create a situation worse than your desired outcomes. A lot of laws make things worse than when you started. And if you've done that, well, then you're really in trouble. But unfortunately, that happens quite a bit. The sort of the final thing on the checklist is achievable results. Even if you meet all of these things, and if you do meet all of the other criteria, your chances of having a successful law are pretty good. But still, oftentimes, you don't get the results that you expect. And for municipalities who bear the cost of and the brunt of enforcing laws, if you're not getting the results, it's a very serious drain on your resources. So you always have to look at the laws you've created to make sure you're continually getting the result you want. Once again, because you're wasting your resources, but also because you're telling your population that the laws, your laws, are really not of a benefit to their society. And that's, and you know, that starts to again take us into the non-compliance field. When we look at the drug laws and compare them to this checklist, they fail in every single one of them. Unfortunately, that's not unusual. There's always examples of laws that have perhaps gone too long and society's changed. I mean, there's lots of reasons why, but we do have a number of laws that fail these criteria and don't produce the results. And it's the responsibility of the lawmakers to continually look at them and ensure that they do. But the problem that I see more than anything here with the drug laws is that all these things that, you know, they may not work, they're causing problems and everything, they cause the non-compliance, it's adults that are doing it. And adults generally have the ability to pick and choose. Yeah, you can go faster than the speed limit, you can put a secondary suite in even though the laws don't, you know, say not to. You do all of these things, but you still have the fundamental belief that laws should be obeyed. But the drug laws are affecting our children. The children, the young generations are the ones that are being told, hey, yeah, there's a law there, governor. It's a serious one. It's a federal level. Don't worry about it. We're not going to enforce it. You know, that's a hell of a message that we're sending. And the ramifications of that are very serious when we go back to the importance of having voluntary compliance. We're teaching our younger generations that, you know, if you don't agree with the law, you don't need to obey it. That's just a very bad thing to do. The government's models to function, there has to be a fundamental respect for society. And the respect generally flows out of your laws and your systems. So what's at stake here isn't just bad laws, stuff like that. What's at stake is a fundamental loss of respect in our younger generations of our ability to make laws that make sense, our ability to have a society and a structure that it's important to voluntarily comply with, essentially. And that's why I feel so strongly that we have to reform. As a lawmaker, all lawmakers, we have to make sure that our laws work for the protection, the long-term protection of our free society.